What's going on, guys? This is Edwin from Artistic Automotive Detailing and the UDC Movement. And today I have the privilege and the opportunity to be able to interview one of my personal friends, a mentor of mine, somebody who's known me from the beginning, not only from Artistic, but also the UDC Movement. That is Patrick Bedavid. And for those of you guys who don't know who Patrick is the CEO and founder of PHP Agency. He's also the creator of Valuetainment and the host. And Pat, I just wanna tell you thank you so much for the opportunity.
Absolutely, man. It's good to have you.
Thank you. So Pat, really quick, tell us a little bit about yourself. Obviously, you know, I just said all the great things. A lot of people know who you are. A lot of people see what you've created in your companies, Valuetainment, the books you've written. But who's really Pat? Like, who's really Pat? Is it, do you come from oil? Did you win the lottery? Did your parents give you the money?
Yeah, so you know, when I got married to my wife, everybody at our wedding, we had two sides. We had all the Middle Easterns on one side and all the Americans, Caucasians on one side. And we're playing Middle Eastern music, no one's dancing. Finally, one of our friends, he gets up and he says, look, I can tell everybody's concerned a little bit here because you're wondering if this marriage is gonna work. A guy from Iran married to a guy from Texas, a girl from Texas, what do they have in common? And then eventually he said, look, I figured it out. There's two things they have in common. Oil and weapons of mass destruction. They're gonna do perfect because Jennifer's from Texas, I'm from Iran, but everybody started dancing that at a good time. No, my story is very simple. I was born and raised in Iran, lived there 10 years. We were there when the war happened. 6 weeks after Khomeini died, we escaped. We went to Germany, lived at a refugee camp for 2 years. My parents got a divorce, came to the States at a 1.8 GPA in high school. I went to the Army, got out of the Army. Wanted to be a bodybuilder, didn't work out. I worked at Bally's. From Bally's, I met a girl who introduced me to Morgan Stanley, Dean Witter, got into the financial industry, then went to Transamerica. 7.5 years later, we started PHP Agency in October of 2009 with 66 agents out of one office. And then 3 years after that, November of 2012, we started Valuetainment, the channel Valuetainment. I think our first year we got 200 subscribers or something like that. Second year we got 700 subscribers. And then it took us 3 years and 11 months to get 100,000 subscribers. And it took us 4 months to get 200,000 subscribers. And then now PHP's gone from what it was to 3,200 agents in 49 states.
So, wow.
Yeah.
So
no oil, man. I wish we had oil. Right? I would have loved it. Yeah.
So really quick, Pat. 8 years ago, I think it was about seven, 8 years ago, I sat down with you just like this. Obviously, it was different times. And you saw the struggles of my business, Artistic. And one of the things that stuck to me and that changed my business was branding myself. You even made a video about it. You even mentioned my company about it. How important is branding to brand yourself and brand your company for a starting entrepreneur?
So I'll give you a perfect idea. There was two guys. There was you and there was another guy. The other guy was doing concierge services. I coach him as well. He went to Hawaii right now. He's living in Hawaii with his wife and his kid. And both of you did a good job with customer service. With you, when you serviced my car the first time, I will never forget when you serviced it, I saw the paper on the bottom that you put. What do you call it, on your, floor mat that you put, and Artistic Auto Detailing. You put the mint, then you send me a thank you card, and I was so impressed by it. And then I said, you know what, I like what this guy's doing, and then you kept following up, and you were doing all, hey Patrick, I think it's time to service your car. Every 2 weeks I would get a text from you. I think it's time to service your car. And by the way, you already know I don't like the rain thing, so you would say, hey, just so you know, it's not gonna be raining this week. So if you'd like me to service your car, I'd like to come by today. And then you were consistent, you were persistent, so we started doing business, and then all of a sudden, it grew to what it is today, and I'm proud of you for what you've done with your business, but I think it goes back to the most basic fundamental thing of sales is how you treat your customers. And you are very good at treating your customers in a world-class way, so you keep getting customers wanting to do business with you over and over and over again.
Awesome. It has completely changed my business, I'll tell you that much. I think when I took that advice, put it into action, it just completely took my business upside down for the best, and I continue to do it. You know, everything that you teach me, the 2-3 minutes that you ever give me here and once in a while, I appreciate it, I cherish it, and I just run with it, you know? And as you can see it, I always show you the results that I get out of it.
Now you do every
now,
time.
As far as when you do your branding and stuff like that, obviously in the beginning you do it yourself. At what point in your business do you feel Or do you feel that somebody needs to get professional help, where, you know, people, a team that starts to help you to brand, to do social marketing, you know, because, you know, you got to branch out of that. You can't do it all yourself.
Right. So you're talking about, if I'm a detailer, when do I consider going out there and hiring a marketing agency to do my social media for
exactly.
me?
Exactly.
Okay. So first thing you got to do is you start off by testing. Like, for instance, if I'm doing a detailing business today, if I decide to become a detailer today, I know detailing is all about visual, right? So what social media apps are the best for visual? Instagram and Snapchat, those two are at the top. Probably Instagram would be higher than Snapchat, because with Instagram, I can go tap into other markets. Snapchat, you can't really do that. With Instagram, it's easy. Hashtags, follow this, follow that, comment here, comment there, and you can go look at people that are detailing in nice cars and, hey, who details your car? There's a lot of ways you can do it. I can literally spend a month, if I was a newer guy, I could spend 3 hours to 5 hours a day on Instagram for 1 month straight, and I would probably get 100 customers to detail cars with regularly just from Instagram, because I'd look for keywords. So I'd look for Santa Monica. If I'm in the city of Santa Monica, if I'm in San Diego, I look at San Diego. If I'm in Toronto, I look at Toronto. So I would take 6, 7, 8 keywords, auto detailer, Toronto, and then I would look for my city, and then I would look for car wash. So if somebody got a car wash, and you know, somebody gets a car wash, they post a picture of their new car, and I got a car wash, I would message that guy, say, hey, that's a nice car. How did you like the car wash? I'm in the Toronto area, I wouldn't mind servicing your car for you. I wouldn't mind doing this. We do it upscale. This is a nice car. You spend a lot of money. It sounds like you're a professional. You want it to be done by professionals. I'm a professional. I'll come to you wherever you're at. It's Instagram would be a big play, number one. Now, hiring an agency has to do with math. And what do I mean by math? The first thing I want to prove to myself is that I know how to make money with this. That's number one.
Okay.
So if I know how to make money with this thing, then it goes to how big I think. So what do I want to do? So an auto detailer that gets started doesn't necessarily mean this person knows how to build a business. They may just be a good detailer, but they're not a good business person. So they don't handle their finances well. They don't handle their taxes well. They don't save their money. They go to a club, they get bottle service, spend $1,300 just to impress these two girls, and the 62 cars that they service for 3 weeks is a waste of time because they just got a table. That was a waste of money. So if a detailer then thinks big and says, you know what, I want to kind of take over the marketplace and I want to be one of the top 5 guys in Kansas City for auto detailers. How do I do that? Well, then you need help. You need help with people you hire. You need help with the branding. You need help with marketing. You need help with your word of mouth going out there. You need help to find out what portion of your money goes towards marketing. And that's when the business side of you comes out. So if somebody's watching this right now and they're just a regular detailer, there's going to be always different viewers, right? And everybody that's watching. There's the guy that's kind of like you who's watching this saying, man, I'm good at detailing. I got it down. I know what to do. I know what all this other, I get it. But I'm not a good business person. How do I improve in the business side? That's probably a person that's going to build an auto detailing business that makes them $100,000, $200,000, $300,000, $400,000, some even $500,000 a year income just from detailing cars.
My next question to you was like your associations, okay? You've interviewed and you've had dinners, you played golf, you've had cigars with some of the biggest names, Mark Cuban, Robert Greene, Grant Cardone, Magic Johnson. Mm-hmm. Why do you hang out with those people? Why are your associations with those people? How important is association?
So I think the most important skill set anybody can learn and have is how to process issues. I think that's number one. If you notice why a Rockefeller keeps making money is because he watched 18 years of how his father was thinking and making decisions, and he watched his father Rockefeller on how he thought. So what's being passed down to the kids and the next generation is how they think. Nothing more than that. You are a byproduct of how your mom and dad thought. I'm a byproduct of how my mom and dad thought. And so if I keep thinking that, well, I'm gonna get the same results. I have to shift my thinking for me to process issues in a completely different way. For instance, so imagine if I'm raising a family where they are so scared about losing money and losing everything all the time. Every time I make money, I'm like, no, I don't wanna put that money into social media. No, I don't wanna buy this course. Let's just say you come out with a program where you built a $1 million business and you take this and you come out with a manual. Hypothetically, you come out with a manual. And this manual cost thousands of dollars of your time, but you sell this manual for $500 to somebody who's not a UDC member, And this manual, if I'm a UDC member and I buy what is a monthly membership right now, $39?
Yeah.
Okay, so if I paid for the whole 12 months and it shows that I'm committed to the UDC, you give that manual to me for free. If I don't buy annual membership, I just do $39 a month, I have to buy it for $199 from you, hypothetically. I want to buy that manual if I'm somebody that wants to build a big business, because I'm going to learn from you on how you do your systems, your sales, your marketing, your advertising, your hiring, your follow-up, your script. I want all of that. So I'm willing to invest money into that versus somebody else going to say, oh, I don't want to spend money into that. I don't know if I want to keep doing this. I don't know if there's... So I want to know how people think. And you didn't get lucky. I asked you a question today. How many Ferraris you've serviced? You said what? 500 Ferraris, 600 Lambos, 700 Rolls Royce, 800 Bentleys, 2 Bacanis, 7 Bugattis. I think this is what you told me. And then the big Rolls Royce dealership in Beverly Hills, the Ferrari dealership. You didn't get lucky getting all this stuff. This is not like you came from a family that passed their business over to you. You figured out how to do this. How did 600 Ferrari owners trust you with their $300,000 machine? How? That is a very sensitive thing. One scratch on a Ferrari, it's not a $200 fix.
Right.
You do one thing wrong, that's a couple $1,000 mistake. So they trust you. These people trust you. 3 billionaires have you doing business with them. So in the auto detailing business, I would be a sponge to be wanting to learn from you.
So yeah, so it's associations. Well, you get it from your associations. Yep. That's awesome, Pat. That's awesome. Now, you, Pat, between Valuetainment, YouTube, PHP Agency, your books, you mentor millions of people around the world, one way or the another, right? Mm-hmm. Does Patrick but David have mentors? And when do you stop having a mentor?
Oh, you'll never stop having mentors. No, it's never. A lot of my mentors are now my peers that I'm associating with, where we learn from one another. Most of them are dead mentors. Most of them are no longer around. So I read their books. You learn from their mistakes. You learn what they did. But that's never, ever going to stop. It doesn't. When you're president of the United States, what do you have? You have a vice president. You have a secretary of state. You have a house of... You have, you know, speaker of the house. You have so many different people that their job is to give you a different perspective. So you say, I want to come out with this tax bill. They say, if you come out with this tax bill, this community takes a hit. Then these guys debate, and you watch these 6 people that debate, 3 on this side, 3 on that side. You're supposed to see what makes sense. Then you make your decision. Nobody becomes a president and says, I know everything. Here's how we do it. We move forward. So today I was doing a conference call in the morning, and one of the guys I told the following to, this is a guy that's got a very strong ego, very, very strong ego. And I said, one of the things that made Rockefeller very special, here's Rockefeller. When Rockefeller would come home, he would do the following. Every time he would get very cocky, very arrogant, he would come home and he would say following. He would say, you know what? Stop. Stop thinking you're so good. Stop being so damn cocky. Stop it. Why are you talking like that to people? Stop being so arrogant. You're so annoying. Relax yourself a little bit. And he says, the reason why I did this every night was because I knew the moment I thought I was already there, there's no next level for me. So ego becomes the enemy, right? So if I don't constantly strive to want to have mentors and people around me that push me and challenge me, what is the next level for me? I don't have all the answers. You don't have all the answers. A president doesn't have all the answers. You know, Elon Musk doesn't have all the answers. What makes everybody else think they have the answers? They don't. So I like to surround myself. Like, matter of fact, even right now, I am not the smartest employee in our company. Think about that. I am not the smartest person in our company, not even close. Our president, Tom Ellsworth, can do laps around me with how intelligent, how bright he is. Now he's, you know, went from being a mentor for 5-6 years on my board telling me what to do, and now he's our president of our company. Why? Because I know I don't have all the answers, and I'm very comfortable with that. Very comfortable with that. So it's wanting to know that that game never stops. And Ed, when it comes back to one thing, somebody asked me a question the other day. They said, so Pat, you know, when does all this stuff stop, man? When do you stop? We're like, what's enough? And what are you going to do with this? And what are you going to do with that? And what if I want to do this? And what if I want to do that? And I don't think you should work that hard. And I don't think you should do this. I think balance. I think this. I said, look, you say all that stuff. That's great. Here's what it comes down to. When you're by yourself, no one's around. Okay? When you're by yourself, no one's around. What do you really want your life to look like, and who do you want to be? If you can answer those 2 questions, everything else is irrelevant. And by the way, The person who ends up becoming the president, or the person who ends up running a multi-billion dollar company, or the person that ends up becoming a millionaire or multi-millionaire or deca-millionaire or billionaire, or owning a sports team or being in the history books or creating a revolution in our educational system or taking a, you know, artistic auto detailing from a regular detailer to becoming what it is today, is the guy that thinks bigger and is clear on what they want. Very few people are like that though. The person who's watching this, who thinks like that, it's game over.
That's amazing. Yeah. And how does somebody who's just starting off, who wants to get mentorship from somebody, you know what I mean? How do they be creative? How do they get somebody to, how did somebody get your attention? The mentorship that you've given me, it's been years of being persistent and following up with you and just, and.
But how many times do I not respond back to your message?
I text you 15, 20 times and I'll get one thumbs up out of that. You know what I mean? He's a big emoji fan, you know? I don't take it personal because I understand you're very busy, but I persist and I don't quit and I constantly, back then when you used to live in California, it wasn't about, I didn't want to go service your cars. I mean, I wanted to take care of your cars, but I wanted that minute when you were coming in and going to your car, those two minutes were priceless to me. So how does somebody get a mentor, somebody that they want? Do they have to be super creative? I mean, nobody can just come and knock on your door and say, hey, Pat, can you mentor me, right?
A lot of people do it. A lot of people will walk in here and just out of nowhere. Yesterday, we had a very, very famous officer in the military and a former pilot for Israel military was here. He's an incredible author, 50-year-old money manager, manages a lot of money, a few hundred million dollars of people's money he manages. He does well for himself. A lot of people come here all the time to knock on the door and just kind of want to introduce themselves and they start from there. But I will tell you, for somebody like me, if you haven't watched all the Valuetainment videos or studied my content and you come and say, I want to learn from you, it devalues your approach because you don't know what you're doing. So for instance, when we went to interview Mark Cuban, so my approach with Mark Cuban is he's an entrepreneur, I'm an entrepreneur, I'm thinking about moving to Dallas. So I come to Dallas, I meet with Governor Perry and I meet with Nolan Ryan. And then I meet with Mayor Masso from Frisco because initially we wanted to go to Frisco and then we didn't. So then I met with Don Nelson. Then I met with Donnie Nelson, who's son of Don Nelson, who, you know, at that time lives in a nice community here in Frisco. And we got connected. So finally I said, hey, how can I help you? So he said, I have an app called CyberDust. Tell me how you think about it and you like it. I said, okay, let me look at it. I went through it. I said, great. Here's what I can do. How about we do video and I bring a lot of value to CyberDust? And I think we can bring you 500 subscribers to CyberDust. Okay, great. We ended up bringing over 5,000 people who downloaded the app. Wow. Okay. So we do the video and all this other stuff relationship-wise. And then at the end of the video, his favorite book of all time is Atlas Shrugged. So I say, I got a gift for you. He opens it up and he says, oh, Atlas Shrugged, this is probably my 8th copy. That I said, do you have this? He says, of course, I got 8 copies. I said, but this is first print, first edition from 1950 something. He says, no. I says, this is original sleep. It's a $1,500 buy from a very, you know, place. And he says, oh my gosh, thank you. So it's willing to go that extra mile to not waste someone's time to show that, listen, I appreciate your time for what we did. And so when you do that, the person, the next time you ask, they'll say yes, because it's not only a one-time thing. Look, I think a lot of times people treat business like one-night stands, and you can't. You know, one-night stands may be cool to brag about it with your friends, but quite frankly, think about it this way. Let's consider that with the one-night stand for some of these guys that maybe speak that language. Let's talk that language. Let's just say I do have a one-night stand with a girl. If she doesn't want to sleep with me the second time, what does that say about me?
Yeah.
It says I'm not good in bed.
Yeah.
But if I'm that good in bed, she probably wants a second or third time. So if you do business with a business guy and it's only a one-night stand and he doesn't ever want to do business with you again, guess what he's telling you? You're not good in business. I don't want to do business with you again. So it stays right there and it's limited. I don't want that. I want a bunch of marriages with business people and relationships that I want to build that I bring so much value to them that they say, dude, this guy doesn't just suck stuff from me. I give him so much. He gives me so much. This is a very mutual relationship. Let's continue doing that. So whoever's watching this that starts the relationship that way, you ain't gonna have a hard time building a lot of strong relationships in life.
Yeah, I know with your new book that just came out, when I wanted to talk to you, you told me, I need you to go buy my book.
Yep.
I need you to read it, and then you text me back. And even when I text you back, you still told me, what did you think about it? And I wrote you everything, what I thought about it. And then the next day you gave me a call and you gave me 5 minutes. And I value that, you know what I mean? Because I love the fact that you're challenging me to make sure that I'm not wasting your time and that I value your time. And to me, I appreciate that. because it goes to show that you want to see how much I care, and in return, you know, I get 5 minutes of your wisdom and your call, and to me it means a lot. You know what I mean? It's just not given to me, and I think that's the best. But when you were let's stick to the subject of mentoring. When nobody knew you in the financial industry, when you really started, when in the beginning, how did you get the attention of people who were higher that you wanted to get mentor, who didn't even know who Pat was?
Yeah, so how did I get their attention? Meaning as a customer or as a relationship?
As a mentor, so somebody to give you advice, start mentoring
you.
So
I'll give you an idea. So it's with tiers, right? So you don't all of a sudden go and meet with a $3 billion guy. That doesn't all of a sudden happen, unless if you're doing business with that person, then maybe yes. But you don't just say, hey, Mr. $3 billion guy, how can I get to spend a couple hours with you? And I want to come to your stadium, and I want you to bring me into your man cave, and I want us to talk about everything in life, and especially politics. It's not going to happen, right? So I'll give you the first one. The first one for me was a guy named Jamie Hepp, okay? So I'm out of the Army, I'm working at Bally's. I realized I don't want to be a bodybuilder because I didn't want to do all the growth hormone and steroids. It just was too much. And the more I partied with those guys, it was a terrible life. They were all on drugs. Not all of them. Some of them were all on drugs and they were not happy. So I said, I'm not doing bodybuilding. I'm not going to go into that, and I'm not going to do Hollywood. I'm going to go into business. I go and decide that I'm leaving Bally Total Fitness and I'm leaving this place. So I go and do interviews at different places. I go and interview with a guy on 10 freeway in Overland. I don't know if you know freeway, 10 freeway in Overland. You exit 10, you make a left, and it's right there with his office. It was called the Advertising Group or something like that. I go meet with this guy, Jamie Hepp, and he interviews me. And I'm sitting there saying, oh my gosh, this is an impressive guy. So he said, I want you to come tomorrow for the job interviews. I said, I will never do this job because it's not for me, but I'm interested in you. If you don't mind, I wouldn't mind following up with you. He says, no problem. Year and a half goes by, I keep his card. I hadn't met somebody that impressive in my life. And I think he's like 4 or 5 years older than me. So year and a half later, I call him back. I said, hey, Jamie, you interviewed me year and a half ago. You probably don't remember because everybody says this, but I kept your card and I wanted to make sure I get a chance to take you out to lunch. So we go to Macaroni Grill in Cobra City, Santa Monica area. So he thinks that I'm coming because I want to work for him. So he brings his hottest sales girl at that time, Tabitha. I think her name was Tabitha. Beautiful girl. She's sitting right in front of me. She's showing the cleavage and everything, and she's wearing a short skirt. And I have zero interest in this girl. Like, literally, it's as if she's a guy sitting in front of me, and I can't even see, and I'm not even turned on by her.
How old are you at this time?
I'm 22 years old at this time, right? So I told him, Jamie, I appreciate you bringing her. Is this your wife or girlfriend? No, so you brought her because you want me to be attractive. I have zero interest in the business. You're very attracted, not for me. I'm very interested in you.
You're telling him this.
I'm telling him this right up front. I said, Jamie, let me tell you something. I plan on being somebody in my life. I'm going to be somebody in my life. I have to either die or be somebody in my life because my parents sacrificed everything to come to America. I'm going to be somebody in my life, and I want to learn from you. And every 90 days to 6 months, if you allow me to, I would love to take you out to lunch. Anywhere we go, I'm always going to do my best to bring value to you as well. All I ask you is to mentor me. So he starts talking all this. I said, tell me about your disciplines. What time do you wake up? What do you do? How do you organize yourself? Schedule, calendar, everything we went through. Then we went again and again and again. So finally, we went to this restaurant on Victory. It was called Bamboo or something like that, Argentinian restaurant on Victory and, not Overland. It was Victory and, I'll think about it here in a minute. It's right where the old Bally Total Fitness was in Sony Studios. So we go over there and we would sit there. And every time we're sitting there having this Argentinian soup, it was spicy. I would always talk to everybody that walked past us, everybody. Hey, how you doing? Nice suit. Hey, I like your jacket. Hey, tell me what you do. Hey, how you doing, waiter? So where, I saw you last time. So he says, man, you talk to everybody. I said, I talk to everybody. He says, do you mind coming to my office and training our guys on how to talk to everybody and why you're so comfortable? I said, no problem. And every time I brought him a book, every single time I brought him a book. And I went to his office. Through his office, I met a guy named Chad Terpstra. You remember Chad?
Yeah.
So he was introduced to me by this guy. And then Chad eventually now runs our office, I think, in Atlanta. And he helped with Florida. He helped open Florida the first time with John. Long story short is this. We moved forward at 25 years old. I spoke at Glendale High School. I went to Glendale High School. I was a 1.8 GPA. They asked me to come back and speak. There was 600-700 people in the auditorium. He came as well, Jamie. And then from there, our relationship grew. I have probably sent him, if you ask Jamie and you go on Facebook and type in Jamie Hepp, and you say, Patrick spoke about you, you should go Facebook him and just ask him. Okay, I dare everybody to do this. Go and type in Jamie Hepp, and the advertising group. White guy, got a couple kids, you'll see the pictures. Sent him a message and said, Patrick spoke very highly of you in this video. And, you know, how many books has Patrick sent you every time you met him? Look what he'll tell you.
Really?
He'll probably tell you, I don't know, but probably Pat sent me over 20 books from that time. I send him books all the time, all the time. And our relationship flourished, and eventually at one point I asked him to, I wanted to hire him to be our president. He said no because he wanted to go into a different direction. And he's doing good. He's doing good for himself in Santa Monica. And the guy is, you know, quality leader, big leader, big leader, John Maxwell. But the moral of the story is this. No one here knows who Jamie Hepp is. You don't know who Jamie Hepp is.
No.
But I know who Jamie Hepp is and the impact of my life. Okay, and Jamie Hepp may not be a famous celebrity, but he changed the way I viewed leadership, and I really liked his way and his approach. He was willing to teach me. Then from Jamie Hepp, you graduate. So your person could be somebody local who's doing very well that's going to teach you, and then from there you go to the next person, and 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 then all of a sudden one day your mentor could be a governor or a billionaire or a millionaire or a celebrity or a successful author or something like that that keeps continuously growing. But you just make sure all these relationships that also impacted, you water them as well. You don't just say, oh, I got plenty out of this next. Oh, I got plenty. You water them as well because at some point of your journey, they help contribute towards your success. So I think instead of going for the moon, you know, it's like going to a nightclub. Let me tell you about going to a nightclub. When you go to a nightclub, I had a game when I would go to the nightclub, and I think it worked 70% of the time because this was my game. Every time you go into a nightclub, let's just say there's 600 people in a nightclub, okay? Let's say it's 300-300, even split. 300 female, 300 males. Okay, Aziz, you can take notes on this one here if you're listening, okay? 300-300, okay? Out of 300 girls, how many of those girls in there would you say are drop-dead gorgeous that every guy is looking at?
Out of the 300, 100, maybe 50?
You think drop-dead? I'm saying drop-dead.
Oh, drop-dead, maybe 10?
Maybe 10. Yeah, is 10. That fair, 3%? So guess who I talked to? Not them. I go to second tier, and I looked at 20 of them. I would spot 20 of them. I would make one round. And during my one round, I complimented 20 of them in an area that no one else is going to compliment. For instance, everybody compliments the butt. Oh, girl, you got a great butt. Yeah. I'm not complimenting your butt. An area that she took attention to or spent more than 30 minutes of time to fix. So for instance, hey, listen, I love your hair. I know you put a lot of time into it. It looks amazing. Hey, I love your eyebrows. I'm an eyebrow guy. Your eyebrows look amazing. By the way, your toes, man, beautiful toes. It's all straight. It's perfect. So I would go and I would say all these things, and I'm testing it out. By the second round, and by the way, it's a tap, it's a whisper, it's a walk-off. It's so not a
seconds.
Conversation. Tap, whisper, walk-off. By the time I would come around, guess who's looking for me? 20 girls.
Really?
And the next round, they're talking to me. So the top tier girls, the 10 of them, are all saying, who is this guy? Why are these 20 girls keep whispering something to him? Is he somebody? Then the top 10, one of them was interested, and then boom, 70%.
You're aware that majority of the people who are watching this video are going to go try to
the
club.
They're all about to get laid.
right now, everybody's thinking, no,
let me tell
everybody's going to.
Well, there's a side of me most people don't know because, you know, for me, when I made a decision to stop playing, I made a decision to stop playing. But I was very good at the game and I enjoyed the game, but it was a waste of my time. It got old very quickly, that Hollywood scene and the girls got old very quickly. And I used those same principles in the game of business. And by the way, you know what was the easiest thing? The easiest thing to get your friend to also get a girl or meet a girl was so much easier. Here's how it was. This is how simple it was. So think about it this way. Let's just say it's me, you, Aziz, and Paul, we go to a nightclub,
okay.
Right? And I would ask you, I'd say, Edwin, tell me five girls you like in this place here. You would spot the five girls, okay? Tell me, the girl in the red dress, the girl in the green dress, the girl in this and the girl in that. Okay, cool. All right, I'll be back. What are you doing, Pat? Dude, I'll be back. So I'd go to them, I would say, hey, how you doing? First line, by the way, I'm not interested, I got a girl. This is not for me. My buddy right there, let me tell you who he is. He's the most ridiculous guy locally who does ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. And he really likes you, he wants to buy you a drink. Cat bit his tongue, you okay if I ask him to come over? Why don't you ask him to come over? How about I go introduce him to you? Sure, boom. One of the five would say yes. So I edified you, and she wanted to talk to you. You're not doing, you didn't get rejected. So if she said no to me, she didn't say no to me or no to you.
Right.
It just said no in the air. You understand what I'm saying? Yeah. So the next thing you know, Edwin's getting one of the five girls. And I'll say, Edwin, now, so we'd go on, I'll say, hey, whose turn is it tonight? And I would say, you know what, Ed, you've been down the last couple weeks, man. I'm gonna get somebody tonight for you. And I would go. And this would work every single time, every single time. So this goes back to somebody watching this, is if you're doing your auto detailing, and let's just say you and I are teamed up, hypothetically. And I go, and you're somebody that's detailing, I'm somebody that asks for an upgrade. Hey, by the way, this is a very nice car. One of the things I noticed with a car like this is that it doesn't look like, you know, it looks like from the rain that we've had in the last month, there's some stains here that requires us to use a certain, you know, whatever it is, chemical to get rid of it, to make it a lot cleaner, but that's $75. But I wanted to make sure I ask you before we do this. So take us another 25 minutes, but we're gonna make sure this thing becomes flawless and you won't have to do that for another 3 months. Oh, great, no problem. And by the way, the guy that's over there, he's one of the best with this chemical. It's not always him today, but we have him today. So I just want to offer it to you. If you don't want to, it's okay. But next time, then the guy who's very good, I may not be here. But if you want to, we can service it today. Yes, $75 sale. You split whatever the commission is right there. I think that's the example I'm trying to give right here is not how to get laid. The example I'm trying to give right, although some of you guys are going to get laid, and this one's going to be using the same pad shirt, some nuggets here. Yeah. So the idea here is to show one, how to close and how easy sales is, and two is how to leverage somebody to upsell your product to whatever else that product may be.
Nice.
I don't think you were expecting an answer like
no,
that.
No, I wasn't. I wasn't. I think everybody here is taking notes right now as we speak.
I got to go to the club tonight.
And sticking with the mentorship, obviously, yeah. when somebody wants your attention, and I, you know, like I was telling you during lunch, people always send me, you know, messages that they want me to mentor them, and they just want it. They just want to be. They have to be creative, you know what I mean? They have to grab your attention. They want to know that the value and the time that you're going to give to them, it's going to be used properly, and they're going to go out there and actually show results. How is it nowadays? I noticed that like people send you stuff. Like I know that somebody sent you a shoe that said, now I got my foot in the door. How do you respond to things like that? Is that something that really grabs your attention and says, you know what? This person went out of their way. I'm going to go ahead and give them 5 minutes, 10 minutes. I'm going to get them on a call, this and that.
Did you read that article the guy sent us from London that this kid watches the video, sends the shoe to the prime minister, okay? Saying, I want to get a shoe foot in the door. The prime minister responds back and asks the guy to come and meet him, and BBC does an article on this, and the guy says, I learned this from Valuetainment on video where Pat's a send a shoe.
Really?
It made the paper. That's how it was, the cover story for these guys that they use. I think it's just creativity, man. That's all it is. You know, it always goes back to creativity. There's so many ways. Look, let's go back to the girl example. And the only reason I keep going back to girls is because the audience you have is a younger audience, okay? So let's make a girl a client. If you and I want to date this one girl named Rachel, hypothetically, that you like and she's amazing. Okay, great. How do you get Rachel to notice you? Because you're trying to get noticed by Rachel, right? Think about these strategies. What would be some of the first things you would do? This is what I would do. I would make sure I find out who her friends are. I would make sure I know what her mom likes, what her dad likes, and if she's got a brother or a sister. I'm gonna make sure those people love me. So I'm gonna get them, mom, I'm gonna go and say, listen, I see you're always working on Sundays. Do you mind if I mow your lawn today? If I'm a 14-year-old kid. Oh, darling, that would be so nice. Ma'am, let me see if I do a good job for you. And if I do, next time, you can pay me. But I just want to do a good job for you today. Is that okay? It's hot. I would rather have you stay inside today. What a sweet boy he is. Hey, Mr. Jones, I noticed you were working hard with the car here all day long. Is there any way I can help you? Can I get you something? All this other stuff. Oh, you know what? Thank you, son. You know, I'm okay. But thank you. Great. Then I would see her friends, and I would go to her friends, and I would say, hey, you know, I just want to let you know, I saw what you did today in class. It was awesome. Great job or whatever. Then I'm going to go to her favorite teacher and all this other stuff. I'm going to make sure everybody around her loves me. Then I'm going to go ask her out. Then she's going to reject me. But she's going to go and say, do you know who just asked me today? Do you know that kid named Patrick? He wanted me to go out with him. Oh, I love him. He's so sweet. Oh, my gosh. And what'd you say to him? I said, no. Why'd you say I would go out with him? And then Rachel says, hey, I thought about it. You're so sweet. Why don't we go for movies together? Then I go out with Rachel, right?
Right.
That's creativity. It's no difference than that. So this isn't about a shoe only. This is find out what they like. Do a little bit of research. Today, everybody's naked online. Everybody's naked today. Today, somebody can watch. Okay, watch this example here for you. Look at the question I'm gonna ask you. How will you know on Facebook if somebody is a Republican or a Democrat? How?
How would you know?
How would you know? It's very easy. How would you know?
By what they post, right?
Oh, so what can I post for you to know I'm definitely not a Republican?
A comment or
so,
a post?
Such as what?
Something that either they don't like Trump or they don't like the president or
if
whatever.
If I say Trump sucks, what's obvious about who I am? I'm a Democrat.
Yeah.
Okay. What if I say Bernie Sanders should have been a president? I'm a Democrat. What if I say woman power, Hillary would have made the best president? I'm a feminist. I like, you know, I want to protect them. There's so many ways for me to learn about people. So look at those signs. Pay attention to those signs. Everything's out there. Don't be an amateur. Do a little bit more research. Do a little bit more study on the customer that you want, because if you do it right and you get it, and it's not a one-night stand, you'll get it over and over and over again. It'll be a marriage. If you treat it as a one-night stand in a world of sales, when people realize all a guy or a girl is about, like a gold digger. Do you remember a gold digger in high school? Do you remember gold digger?
Yeah.
So think about the gold digger you knew. Don't say the name, but just think about her. Do you remember her?
Yeah.
Okay. Anybody that knew she was a gold digger after two guys and what she did to them, the moment they stopped making money, she switched to another guy, and she was a gold digger. Who wanted to date her?
Nobody
wanted to date her. Everybody already knew this girl's a gold digger. I'm not wasting my time with her. So understand that one right there. It's the same exact thing. If you don't treat your customers right, they're all gonna tell each other. Never use that guy's service. He's the worst customer service. He's a piece of this. They're gonna talk to each other like that, just like we talk like to each other on how you feel about somebody you like or you don't like. So I think it's just being creative, and I think it's being willing to take it above and beyond what somebody else is willing to take it.
That's awesome. Now, you said that some of your mentors that you have are dead. So I'm assuming you mean by the books that you read,
yes,
the way everything that they've done in the past. Now, those mentors, how important is reading books? I know that for myself, I struggled in the beginning to read books. I wouldn't understand it. I would read one page. And how important is reading books for an entrepreneur who wants to grow their business and really expand? Is it just has to be a part of their, can they do it without it, or do they need books and knowledge in order to be able to grow?
See, it's not about can they do it without it. Okay, so yes, I can do it without it. Let's just say, can I make money without reading books? Yes, of course you can make money without reading books. Can I go out there and be a great father without reading books, hypothetically? Yes, you can. What is the benefit of reading books to become a father? You learn what mistakes not to make, and it saves you 6.5 years. That's all it is. So you can either learn this mistake on your own and take 6.5 years, or you can read this book and learn it in the next 2 weeks and save yourself 6.5 years of making this mistake. That's all it is. So yes, you can do it, but it may take you 17 years. If you want to take that long, you go ahead. I don't want to take that long. When I got into the insurance business and I said, I'm going to be doing this business, and everybody told me, Pat, you shouldn't be an insurance man. You're like a technology guy. You need to go to Silicon Valley. You need to do this. I just don't see you as insurance. You should go into real estate. You kill it, bro, in real estate. Everybody said this. I'm doing insurance. It's boring to everybody. I love insurance, okay? But I didn't get into insurance to just be another guy in insurance. I studied everybody. I wanted to find out what, so I studied history. I studied mistakes. I would go and everybody would say, well, that guy right there, he used to make $1 million a year. I said, dude, he only made 150 last year. Yeah, because he made a mistake. Then I would go to him and say, hey, Joe, can I ask you a question? Yes. Man, everybody talks about you and how amazing you were. You mind if I ask a few questions? Yeah, sure. What did you do right and what did you do wrong? He says, let me talk to you about what I did wrong. So when I was doing the business, the guy that I was working with, he got together with my girl and it broke my heart. And when it broke my heart, I became his enemy and I hated him. And I had this bitterness for 3, 4, 5 years. And instead of just removing and doing my own business, I made it all about revenge and I lost everything. And nobody wanted to be around me because I was so bitter and vengeful. And so, wow, what a great thing. So he says, one, make sure you know who your friend is. And two, boom, boom. So I said, okay, cool. The other guy, what did you do? I asked everybody's mistakes, is what I wanted to ask. Everybody. What did you do wrong? Because it's easy to say what you did right. What I want to know is what you did wrong. Everybody knows what to do right. What do you do right? Don't kill people. Don't fool around with someone's girl. You know, don't sleep in. Don't be lazy. Don't, you know, everybody knows, do this stuff. Okay, great. But I want to know what mistakes you made. Let me tell you what the mistake I made. I did this, I did that. So eventually that took it to a whole different level. So somebody watching this right now saying, hey, what do I do myself as a, you know, as a detailer? What like if you made a video and said the 20 mistakes I made as a detailer, you know how much value that is? Tens of thousands of dollars if you made a video. How many guys would love to watch it? Think about it. You're probably going like this right now, right? Watching this. Yeah. He's going to make a video and said the 20 mistakes you made as an auto detailer. I want to know that because that saves me 16 months. So reading books and being subscribed to content like yours allows me to get experience from somebody else that already made the mistakes and cost them money that I don't need to make.
That's awesome. That's good. So you, how many books have you read so far?
I would say I'm at 1,300 right now.
1,300.
1,300. So you got to realize I didn't finish my first book until I was 21 years old.
Really?
I've never read a book cover to cover. Never.
So what are you averaging on books right now? How many books do you read?
I will do anywhere. A good year will be 100 plus. A bad year will be 50 books.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow, that's amazing. Now, really quick, we have a lot of UDC members who are struggling, you know, starting off just the way I did and just barely making ends meet. What would you, but they're on fire. I mean, they have the heart, they want it bad. What would you say to somebody if they came up to you, you didn't know me, and somebody just told you, you know what, I'm a detailer, I'm struggling, I live in the projects, I do whatever, but I'm hungry, and you saw the fire, and what would be some of the advice that you would give them off the bat to do?
Find a model and duplicate them. It's very simple. Find a model. Find somebody that you can, when I say model, I mean find an example. Like find somebody who is doing a good job and get as close to that person as possible. So for instance, if I know it's you, a lot of people from Valuetainment, I sent your way so they follow your content and now they're part of UDC. And people always tell me, hey, I want to run a good detailing thing. What do I say? The number one guy you got to follow is, you know, Edwin Lopez, Artistic Auto Detailing. The guy is the best of the best. The only guy I know that's service 7 Bugattis, 2 Bacanis, what, 500 Ferraris, let me see if I'll get it right. 500 Ferraris, 600 Lambos, 700 Rolls Royce, 800 Bentleys, over 1,000 Mercedes, right? That's not a, if there was a leader's bulletin for who's done that, it's not that many people who have done that, right? I'd be modeling you, I'd be learning from you. But here's what I'm gonna tell the guy that's struggling, that's got fire. Do you know which of you guys are gonna make it? Let me tell you which of you guys are gonna make it. I'm gonna give you a guarantee. Those of you guys that are going to make it, you already know you're going to make it. Guaranteed. See, you knew you were going to make it. It doesn't mean you didn't have doubts and you didn't go through struggles, personal life or whatever, but you knew you were going to figure out a way to make this thing work. You knew it. You knew it. You would not stop asking me questions. You would not stop finding ways to say, hey, Pat, I got a question for you. This lady came up to me and wants to do this, and what do you think? Hey, Pat, this is what happened the other day. What do you think? Should I do this? Should I not do this? Hey, what do I do with this? Do I buy the second truck? Show me the map. Hey, this is when I just got this much money from this one guy that I did this. What do you think I need to be doing with this? You ask so many flipping questions, but you implement it. So I knew you were going to make it. There was a part of you that wasn't going to stop till you were going to make it. So the guy here that lives in Pacoima or lives in Sylmar or lives in, you know, right outside of the projects of, you know, Memphis or Miami, whatever, and you are day and night, morning till night obsessed, you already know you're gonna make it. Now it's about how quickly you're gonna suck up all this information so you can do it yourself as well.
Nice, nice. Now before we close out, Pat, I wanna talk about your most recent book, the Drop Out and Get Schooled. Mm-hmm. Tell us a little bit about it. Now, just so you know, a lot of, you know, in detailers, you know, it's not something that you go to college for. It's not something that you even think about in high school. It's not somebody who even says, you know, one day when I grow up, I want to wash cars or detail cars. I want to change that industry. I want to make it a profession, you know. But in your book, you talk about, you know, dropping out of college and getting schooled. Tell us a little bit about it, because there's a lot of guys that never went to college like myself. I actually dropped out of ninth grade in high school, and we feel the society and the way I felt is that the people who have the diplomas, the people who have the degrees had an advantage, and we could never make that kind of money. So we think that people who have diplomas and stuff like that and or degrees are, you know, have more of an advantage in this world. Obviously after reading your book and after being mentored by you and the books that I've read, I've noticed that I've created something more bigger than any diploma could ever give me. So tell us about your book and about the mission on that for what you have.
I mean, honestly, it's written for all of us. We're all the same. I don't have a degree. I'm a college dropout. I dropped out of college the day I was in, I'll tell you exactly where I was at and when I dropped out of college. I was at 17550 Burbank Boulevard off of Encino. This is Burbank and White Oak. If you're familiar with Burbank and White Oak, yes. Off the 101 freeway, there's a Shell gas station there. I lived in that apartment complex for 1 month. And one morning I wake up, I go downstairs, they stole my Toyota Corolla, 1983 Toyota Corolla. Why they would steal it, I have no idea. But they stole a 1983 Toyota Corolla. They found it 6 months later in Tijuana is when they found it, okay? So they stole it. I woke up in the morning and I said, you know what? I'm so sick and tired of going to college. I called Burger King. I was working at Burger King at that time, 17, 18 years old. The night before I finished a bottle of vodka and I had four or five friends over. We were in the jacuzzi till 4 o'clock in the morning. And I said, hey, you know, I quit Burger King. They said, why? I said, I don't have a job. I don't have a car. I can't drive over to you. And then I got four W's from Glendale Community College. And then I'm sitting, I don't know what the hell to do, so I go to the Army and I didn't get a degree and I came back out and then obviously I became an entrepreneur. The purpose of Dropout and Get School is to absolutely revolutionize our current educational system and stop making parents and students feel so guilty about this school system that we have. I do believe 20 to 30% of kids do need to go to college. For instance, if a kid already knows he wants to be an engineer, you gotta go to college to build these things because you gotta learn, right? If you know you gotta be a doctor, you gotta go to college. If you wanna be a lawyer, you gotta go to college to learn the laws and legalities and all this other stuff. But if you wanna be an entrepreneur, there's no reason to at all go to college yourself. You can go take some classes in college, maybe an accounting class for $68 or $200, or you may be taking a finance class for $300, but you don't need to spend $200,000 or $100,000 to go to college. And so I wrote that book and it's gotten banned by two high schools already. Two high schools, you cannot read the book. Teachers confiscated it. The book has gone from kids reading it to now parents are reading it, to now teachers are reading it, to now politicians are reading it. It's become a pretty controversial book. You can read all the reviews on Amazon. I think it's been out as of the 25th of February, it'll be 1 month that's been out.
Wow. And it's made that much of an impact.
It's made already that much of an impact. It's because people, no one's written about this.
Okay.
So this is like you go on Amazon, you tap in Dropout and Get Schooled, and you read the reviews. You'll see how many people are saying, I feel exactly like this. This is me. I went to college. It was a waste of time. And so they're sharing it all together. So the book is about everybody that's watching this here together.
Well, you know, I didn't go to, I mean, like I said, I dropped out of high school and I just went to a seminar to go for an entrepreneur. And the topic about college came up. And I had just finished reading your book. We had other entrepreneurs there. Some of them went to college, military, small business people, big. And people started disagreeing with the person that was mentoring us. We started disagreeing because she believed that it was important and an advantage to go to college and that you had to go in the. Some of the things, I don't want to spoil the book because there's something that I'm going to ask Pat after this, that she believed that the school wasn't responsible for certain things to teach us before we go out into society. And I disagreed and I brought your book, I gave it to her and I challenged her and I told her, once you read it, I want to know your feedback. But there was a lot of people that went against what she said. They didn't believe it. Yeah. People even got degrees. They were like, no, it did nothing for me. It did nothing for me. So with that said, Pat, before we finish this interview, I need to challenge you, Pat, because I don't know when again I'm going to be able to talk to you. These people love you in the UDC. They follow you. We need to have you on a conference call. What does the UDC have to do to get you on a conference call? And not only that, you'll be able to answer some questions for two or three people who qualify.
So this is a private, not a public conference call. This is a private conference call for only UDC members.
Correct.
And then a couple of them would get like the organizer code to ask me specific questions for that 30 minutes.
Yes.
Okay, I will tell you this. If we get 25 minimum people to order the book, draw more people can order the book, so the more the merrier. Per 25 reviews that you guys put on Amazon that I want to read on exactly what you got out of the book, I'll give you 30 minutes. So if you guys do 25, I'll do a 30-minute private call with you. If you do 50, I'll do a one-hour call with you. It's completely up to you. So if I added 100 and 200 members, Everybody goes, buys the book. In the next week, 2 weeks, they get it. They finish the book. They write a review on Amazon and exactly what they got from the book, specific. I don't just want to say, this was a great book, because I want to read the review. Your story, what happened, what impacted you. Then I'll do a 30-minute call per 25 reviews.
Okay.
So that's a challenge to see if you guys are going to get off this video and go out there and become players because of the challenges I give you, or you're going to go become readers. And I promise you, here's what I can tell you. You go chase skirts, it's very hard to make money. You go read books, all the skirts chase you. That's a much better game to play.
That's awesome, Pat. Well, listen, I appreciate your
time. Absolutely, buddy.
I hope this is not the last time. Hopefully in the near future, we can do this again, follow up and see where we're at in the UDC, some of the members, what they got out of the content. And hopefully we could do this again in the near future.
Looking forward to it.
Thank you, Pat.
You got it, buddy.